is my great pleasure to introduce you to Nahum Melamed from the Embedded Control Systems, who's here to talk with us about near-Earth objects. Nahum?
Yes, good morning. Hopefully everybody can hear me now. And we are going to start about near-Earth objects, near-Earth space objects. We're going to talk about two kind of space objects that are showing on the screen, moving about the Earth. One of them is a satellite, and the other one is an asteroid. The satellite is obviously a man-made object, while the asteroid is made by nature. We're going to talk about both of these type of objects. So slowly, we are going to move to the next slide now. And everybody may ask himself or herself or have been asked questions about space, such as why do we go there and how do we get there and what can we do there. And today we are going to introduce a special topic which is called space junk. And some of those answers sometimes are difficult to give. So we're going to try to give a few answers to those questions. I'm moving to the next slide here. And here, I'd like to ask if any of you has made a telephone call to a really far away place. As hopefully you can see on the screen coming soon, is a person holding a telephone device, talking to his friend perhaps around the globe. And the question is, how does the telephone conversation get from one side of the globe to the other side of the globe? And obviously, it gets through something that's called a communication satellite, which relays telephone conversation from one side of the globe to the other side of the globe. So now, if you're sitting in your room and you're making a telephone call to the other side of the globe, and you point with your fingers, where is that other side of the globe? And you can send it back to me in a note or have a question. So this is how we communicate from one side of the globe to the other side of the globe. And I think if you made a telephone call to a friend in a faraway place, having a communication satellite up in space, it's a good thing. One of those good things that we are doing, for going out into space. Have you seen a television program from a different country, like, for example, the Olympics, or getting the news about what's going on around the globe? This is done via global TV broadcast, also a communication satellite that sits very up high in space and relays the program from where it was produced to your home. If you like to see programs and news from faraway places, then having a communication satellite is a good reason to go out to space. We enjoy programming from faraway places. Switching to the next useful use of space, coming up on the screen is a storm. This is a huge, big storm. I'm going to ask you, what kind of storm is this? And anybody who thought about a hurricane was correct. This is a huge storm that is headed towards the west and is going to collide with the state of, and if anybody said Florida, you were correct. Before we had something that's called weather satellites or meteorological satellites up in space, we could not take pictures of such huge storms headed into the communities, and many people were perished because they did not get an alert in time to evacuate. But today, we can actually send alerts to the people who live along the coastline of those places and ask them to evacuate and save their lives. And so this way, we are actually saving thousands of lives almost every year by telling people to evacuate from those huge hurricane storms that are headed their way. An additional good use of space is to be able to navigate from one place to another. show you something that's called GPS satellites. So now we see a GPS satellite that transmits signals to GPS receivers in your phones or at your home. So how does the GPS receiver knows to tell you where you are on the map and how to get from point A to point B? It uses a constellation of many, many GPS satellites orbiting our planet continuously. Each is sending a signal to your GPS receiver. Inside the receiver, there is a little computer that makes calculations about the geometry of your location. It can figure out your place on the map and send you from your local location to your destination. Everybody uses this on your map, and it's a good use of space, I would believe, because some of us may not be able to read paper maps anymore. We are relying on our GPS receivers to get us to our destinations. And now I'm switching to another interesting use of space, and that is space exploration, which slowly uploads on the screen. Now I can see it. And here you can see a faraway galaxy. How do we take those wonderful pictures of those galaxies? One of the ways is to use a satellite that has a telescope on board that can take pictures of the cosmos and send us those beautiful images of galaxies and nebulas and exoplanets and exostars. Very, very exciting discoveries are being made right now and are expected to be made very soon. So these are all good reasons why we go out to space. But now, how do we actually get from the surface of the Earth out into space? In order to get from the surface of the Earth out into space, we are using a special vehicle that's called a launch vehicle. And here is a launch vehicle rocket that is about to lift off from the ground. It's going to fight the force of, and let's see if you have a good answer to that. Anybody who thought about gravity is correct. The rocket is fighting the force of gravity to deploy something out into space. Can you tell me what's inside the tip of the rocket right now? If you were thinking about a satellite, you were absolutely correct. There's always a satellite inside the tip of the rocket. Sometimes there are people inside the tip of the rocket. How do we call those people that travel from the Earth out into space? If you were thinking about astronauts, you were absolutely correct. So now we deployed a satellite out in space. And in the next slide, we see what the satellite is doing very shortly after being deployed in space. On the bottom left, you can see the satellite is deploying those panels. Those panels are called solar panels. What do these solar panels do for us? If you are thinking about converting solar energy into electricity, you are absolutely correct. For example, let's imagine that on the satellite, there are cameras that can take pictures of our own planet, just like is shown on the screen. They use electricity that was converted from solar energy. Any of you like to be an astronaut one day? Or maybe just travel out into space and take some nice pictures on your phone of our planet Earth and send back home? Anybody who would like to be a space tourist and send some nice pictures of our planet Earth from home, I'd like to hear about it. And maybe if you can make a drawing of yourself being in a spaceship taking pictures of our own planet Earth using electricity that was converted from solar energy. So now let's see what we see on the screen. On the right side, we see a big rocket. It's called Delta IV Heavy. Why is it called Heavy? Anybody can guess why that rocket ship is called Delta IV Heavy? If you noticed that there are three large booster rockets all strapped together at the bottom, creating a really huge rocket, giving it the name Delta IV Heavy. It can launch into space very, very large satellites at the upper stage. And the upper stage is what I'm pointing here. Yes, excellent. On the left side.
Hey, Nahum.
Yes.
We have a question. Do yes. you know how tall the Delta IV heavy lift satellite is?
How heavy it is?
How tall it is, the Delta IV heavy?
Yeah. I don't remember the height of the rocket off of my head. It's quite tall, probably several stories. I'm not going to guess because I'm going to be off, but it's a very large rocket.
Thank you.
You're welcome. I'm going to continue to the left here and see the satellite that was just deployed in space. As you can see on the right side, it has a very large and long solar panel that converts solar energy into electricity. It also has some antennas on board. And in order for the satellite to function correctly, and I can see the answer is 236 feet, thank you, the satellite must be oriented in the right direction. The solar panels must be aimed at the sun, and the antennas must be aimed, let's say, at the Earth to be able to enable communication with the Earth. In order to aim the satellite correctly, it has some amount of fuel and small thrusters that can keep the satellite oriented correctly. So the question is, what happens when the satellite runs out of fuel and it cannot control itself any longer? Anybody can guess what happens to the satellite from thereafter? The hint is at the top of the screen. It becomes man-made junk in space. And then also the upper stage of the rocket on the right side. As soon as it deployed the satellite into space, it becomes another useless piece of space junk floating in space. So this is how man-made space is created. In the next slide, we are going to see the amount of space junk that exists around our planet today. As you can see, our near-Earth space is very contaminated with thousands upon thousands of little space debris floating all about and creating some hazards. If any of you has thought about becoming an astronaut or just a space tourist, you should be concerned, because traveling out into space through this cloud of junk is probably concerning. So that's where we need some bright ideas how to clean space. If any of you has ideas, how would you clean space? How would you perhaps become a rocket scientist that would decide to find solutions to clean space and keep our communications going, our GPS working, our weather satellites giving us alerts? We really need some good ideas here. And maybe you can create some drawings and write your ideas and consult with your siblings or your parents or people who have knowledge. And I'd love to hear about solutions that would clean space for us. Because the main concern about having so much space junk is that those pieces can give us damage. For example, here is an example of a satellite that was destroyed by a collision with a space junk, creating clouds of nuts and bolts and floating pieces, which could continue to collide with other satellites and essentially disable our functioning satellites in space. We really need some bright solutions to this problem. So let me give you an example of a situation that actually has happened in real life. Maybe some of you have seen a space shuttle landing in LA a few years ago. It was a very exciting moment to go up the street and watch the space shuttle landing in LAX and then brought into the California Science Center. I'd like to hear how many of you have visited the California Science Center and either touched or looked at the space shuttle Endeavour that is now in the exhibition. If you did that, you may have noticed that the space shuttle had a few windows up at the top for the astronauts to look out into space. One day when they were traveling in space, a piece of space junk, fortunately a small one, hit one of the windows and cracked it, as you can see on the right side. The astronauts were safe because the window did not actually break down. But had the window broken down because of that, it would have been very, very bad for the astronauts because they were not protected by spacesuits at the moment. So this illustrates the concern that astronauts have when they decide to travel into space. So what can aerospace do about helping those astronauts? Here is one of the solutions that we were actually engaged with. Aerospace creates very small little satellites. They are called picosatellites, just because they are very tiny. Here is a couple of them. Here are a couple of those satellites floating about in space, created by aerospace. Some of those little satellites actually have cameras on board. Let's see what the camera, the camera has done for us. So on the next shuttle flight, we gave them one of those little picosats, and it was released out of the space shuttle, taking a picture back and reporting back to the astronauts that there was no damage to the space shuttle upon liftoff, and the astronauts are safe to land back on the Earth. So aerospace helped with the safety of these astronauts, and it requires people who decide to learn aerospace engineering and rocketry and just become rocket scientists to help out with the safety of our astronauts. So think about becoming an aerospace engineer one day to contribute to the safety of our aerospace assets. Aerospace also built another kind of satellite, which is going to hopefully show up in the next slide. And just by the shape of the satellite, you should be able to guess the name of those kind of satellites. And by looking at the shape of the satellite that aerospace builds, you can create, you can imagine that it's called a CubeSat, a cubical satellite, because it has a shape of a cube. We build many of these.
Nahum, yes, we have a question. How small is a picosat?
Picosat is about the size of a phone, of a smartphone. Slightly thicker than that, but about the size of a smartphone. So really, really tiny. You can hold it in the palm of your hand. So now we are going to go back to this particular CubeSat that was created by aerospace. It was the fourth one in the series, and that's why it's called LCube4. Now it has several devices on board, as you can see here, radio, GPS, deployable panels for energy, and it had some cameras on board. So now we're going to show a sequence of pictures that were taken by the camera on board LCube4, and that's going to be very exciting because we should be able to recognize some familiar features on our globe. Wouldn't it be cool to become a satellite engineer and build little satellites that go out in space and send us those fantastic pictures of our own planet? Think about becoming an aerospace engineer that could build those little satellites with the devices on board, look at the clouds on our planet, the oceans, and in a few seconds, there's going to be this familiar shape going to appear on the screen here, And you can tell me what it is because you already have seen it before in my previous slide. And it's going to come very soon and taken by the cameras on board this CubeSat. So far we are seeing no cover on the mountains and cloud cover on the planet, a lot of ice sheets and lakes in interesting shapes illuminated by the light of the sun. Very cool pictures that our own little AirCube has taken from space, all aerospace made.
Nahum, we have another question. What orbit do picosats fly in? How close are they to the Earth?
They were flying. Oh, okay. Let me answer this in a moment because that interesting shape is coming up on the screen now. And you can see a huge storm that was taken by the camera on board the CubeSat. You can guess what it is because you've seen it before. This is a big hurricane. So we could actually use our CubeSats to alert the people that live near the coastline to evacuate and save their lives by using a CubeSat. So the question was, how close is the PicoSat to the Earth? So that particular PicoSat was hovering next to the space shuttle, which is a few hundred kilometers above the surface of the Earth. It's called near-Earth orbit, near-Earth space, a few hundred kilometers above the surface of our planet. So I think it would be really cool to come in and work for aerospace and build those CubeSats that can take pictures of our planet and help the safety of our astronauts and the safety of our communities. If you would like to become a rocket scientist, you can take cool pictures like the one that's showing up on the screen right now. And what you see there, down at the bottom of the screen, there is a dark spot. A dark spot occurs in the middle of the day. It was also taken by AeroCube 4. And think about what could cause a dark spot in the middle of the day on the surface of the Earth. So anybody who thought about a total solar eclipse was correct. I'd like to see some drawings that you might like to draw to explain how come the sunlight is blocked from the surface of the Earth in the middle of the day. That's something that you should think about. A couple of years ago, I took my family to a total solar eclipse in Idaho, and it was an amazing experience that I would recommend to anyone to visit a location of a total solar eclipse where in the middle of the day it becomes just like middle of the night for a couple of minutes. Very, very cool experience. All of that is taken by our own CubeSat, AirCube 4. So,
what is the lifetime of these Pico CubeSats or CubeSats?
The lifetime is varying. It's anywhere between a few months, and I believe that some of them actually function for a few years. So I would guess anywhere between a few months and a few years. So now let's look at this scenario here. On the left, we see a rocket ship just about to lift off from the surface of the Earth. The rocket engine has lit, and it creates a force that's called thrust that pushes the rocket against the force of gravity out into space. In the middle, you can see the rocket engine at the bottom, which is marked next to the person here. And on top is the satellite that is going to be deployed out into space. On the right side, you see an engine casing that protects the engine from the environment. It looks very bright and new because the picture was taken before launch. When the launch has completed, those pieces become another object of space junk. And they sometimes actually fall back into the surface of the Earth, which will be shown on the next slide. So here you can see a piece of space junk, a used engine casing like that, that falls from space back into the surface of the Earth. I'm not sure if you've seen the sequence, but in this case, it's shown it fell into the ocean. When this happens, the engine casing would just sink to the bottom of the ocean and create no harm. But sometimes it falls on land, and when it falls on land, it can actually cause some damage. So let's look at the next picture here, where some of those engine casings and fuel tanks fell on land and brought into aerospace for our experts to investigate how come those fuel tanks and engine casing did not completely melt out during re-entry through the atmosphere. So this is a question for you. Can you think about why that engine casing and fuel tank did not completely melt out? What caused it to melt out, actually, and why did it not melt out completely? We need some experts in the future that can design those tanks such that they can either fall in the middle of the ocean and cause no damage to anyone, or make them completely melt out during the atmospheric reentry. So tell me what in the atmospheric reentry can cause them to completely melt out. Moving to the next slide here, we summarized the concern that we talked about space junk, that those many, many pieces of nuts and bolts and space junk pieces can collide with functioning satellites and disable them. This is the main concern. And here is an example of a person back in South Africa, I believe, that is looking very, very puzzled at this piece of junk that came from space and could cause damage. Should it hit himself or people or objects? So he says, just get it out of my backyard, please. I need some experts that can do that for me. And here is a lady. I think she's the only known lady that actually got hit by a piece of space junk, holding it. And she says, please find a solution. I don't want to be injured by things that are coming out from space. Here is kind of an illustration of how our near-Earth space looks like. As you can see, there are many, many pieces of objects that we would like to clean. We would like to clean space from these objects. So let me show you how we actually got, how the whole thing got started. In the next movie, you will see the very first two pieces of space junk. I'd like to ask you if you can guess what they are. What are the very, very first two pieces of space junk? And then we are going to move through time and see how we started from just two pieces, which are now circling our globe here. Let me know what they are. And moving through the years, we can see that we keep adding additional amounts of space junk. Soon, we're going to arrive at the current time, and you can see that the amount of space junk is increasing and creates clouds of pieces that are encircling our planet. Initially, near-Earth space, which is the bright yellow region near Earth, but then over time, additional pieces get added all around us. And so any of our future space missions could be in danger of colliding with any of these pieces. We need people with bright solutions to the problem that will tell us, how can we clean space? Maybe you can be committed to give us good ideas how to clean space from the space junk that you can see here. It is today, 2020, and we are going to move forward and show that over the years, space is going to become much, much more dangerous to fly through and use if we don't do something about it and soon. So some of you might choose to become rocket scientists, and spacecraft experts, and bring us some, and creates very creative and bright solutions to the problem of space junk. I think everybody is going to be very, very thankful to you.
Nahum, we have a question.
Yes.
The question is, his son is asking, how do launches today navigate through all that space junk?
Ah, that's an excellent question. So we are trying to find at least the big objects with radar and put them into a list of objects that are known. And there are experts at Aerospace and elsewhere that are calculating the trajectory of the space junk and the trajectory of our satellites. As an example, everybody knows that we have a satellite that's called International Space Station with people inside it. We have to continuously monitor about space junk that could be flying into the space station and cause damage. So the way we maneuver it is the space station has little thrusters that can move it up and down and dodge those pieces. And so that's what we have to do in order to avoid collisions. That's going to be much more difficult going into the future. As you can see here, we are at the year 2200. That's about 180 years away. And we have a solid cloud of space junk there unless somebody becomes committed to clean space for us. Well, thank you for all of you that decided to become aerospace engineers and help us with ideas to clean space. So far we talked about objects that are man-made. Now we are going to move forward to objects that are made by nature. And as you can see here, on the left side, we have the solar system and some strange region of objects that exist between the orbit of Mars and the orbit of Jupiter. Some strange region of objects. We're going to talk about it right now. On the right side, we see a big hole in the ground that was created by an asteroid. And we're going to talk about it very soon. But first, let's see where those asteroids are actually coming from. Let's talk about the origin of asteroids. So earlier, when we talked about good reasons to go out to space, we mentioned that there is a satellite that has a big telescope on board. It's called the Hubble Space Telescope. I invite you to Google Hubble Space Telescope and look at the wonderful pictures that this telescope gives us. Among the pictures are the one that you are seeing on the screen, which is a picture of huge clouds of dust particles floating all about in the cosmos. Those dust particles could get near each other. And when particles get near each other, there's a certain force of attraction that brings them closer and closer together. And you tell me what force it is. What force brings those particles together? If you were thinking about gravity, you were correct. So let's look at what the force of gravity does to those objects. What we see here is a cloud of particles rotating all about here, and those particles are coming closer and closer together by the force of gravity and creating balls of particles, piles of particles that are becoming larger and larger in size. When they become huge in size, the pressure can cause them to ignite. And when they ignite, they become a star. This is how stars are made. Large number of particles just come closer and closer to each other until they grow up and become a star. Not all of the particles become a star. Some of the leftovers become something else. And can you let me know what this something else is? Well, if you were thinking about planets, you were correct. Some of those particles become the planets that orbit the sun, just like our own planet Earth. But not everything becomes a planet. Some of those particles become something else. Can you think what it is? If you are thinking about the moons of the planets, you are correct also. Some of those particles become moons of planets. And then the very, very last leftovers of those particles that did not become the sun or planets or moons, what becomes of them? If you are thinking about asteroids and comets, you are correct. Some of those particles, the leftover particles, actually become asteroids and comets. So now we are going to move to the next slide, which I clicked here, and hopefully it will switch to the next slide. Yes. So now I'm going to give you a quiz. Start from the left and tell me the names of each one of these objects. Obviously, I'm not going to hear the answers aloud, but I'll give you a few seconds to name those objects. As you move on all the way to the right object, there is a little dot there. Anybody knows what this little dot on the very right is? If you are thinking about Pluto, you are correct. But Pluto, is it really a planet anymore? Pluto is not a planet anymore. I'd like you to study why Pluto is not a planet anymore, and I'd like to find two reasons why we don't call Pluto a planet. Not one reason, but two reasons. And you can send me the answers. I'd love to hear about why Pluto is not a planet anymore. If you really like the name Pluto, you can name your next pet Pluto. So now we're going to move to the next slide. In the next slide, there's going to be the answer to this quiz, which hopefully everybody passed with flying colors. There's going to be a new region that did not exist on that slide, and hopefully here it is. And that new region is marked by the red arrow. The red arrow highlights the asteroid belt, which is this region of millions and millions of space rocks that orbit the sun, just like we do, between the planet Mars and Jupiter. Let's give an example of a really, really large asteroid that's in the asteroid belt. The next slide, we're going to see one of those big asteroids lives in the asteroid belt. It's a huge piece of rock. It has its own personal moon asteroid that orbits the big asteroid. By what force? Anybody remembers what force causes the small asteroid to orbit the big one? If you were thinking about gravity, you were correct. The force of gravity makes the small asteroid orbit the big one. Isn't this cool? I think it really is. Unfortunately, this big asteroid is stuck forever in the asteroid belt. It will never come close to our planet. But sometimes those asteroids find their way into our planet. Here is an example of a piece of an asteroid that made it all the way down to the ground. When it hits the ground, it is called a meteorite. And a person holds a piece of meteorite in his hand, which potentially could be as old as our own planet Earth. So let's see what the next slide will be here. All right, the next slide, we are going back to the big hole in the ground, which is called an impact crater. It is located in our neighboring state of Arizona. And if you have not visited Meteor Crater as yet, you can make a plan to go visit. It's an amazing experience to stand at the rim of the crater and look down and see what an asteroid can do. There's a visitor center out there. You can read about asteroids. And in fact, if you are planning to make a trip to the Grand Canyon, which I'm sure many of you will have plans, take a small diversion and visit Meteor Crater and read about asteroids and learn how an asteroid the size of 3 yellow school buses can create a crater the size of 85 yellow school buses across. Can you explain to me how a relatively small asteroid, just 3 school buses in size, created such a humongous crater. 85 school buses in size. So talk to your siblings and to your parents and to your friends. But what could cause an asteroid to create a crater that's much, much bigger than its original size? And I'll give you a hint. It's the energy. So I'd like to hear about your opinions. If you want to educate yourself a little bit more after the quarantine period will pass, I invite you to go and visit at the University of UCLA. They have a nice meteorite gallery where you can touch bigger space rocks and actually talk to the scientists and ask them about what are all those minerals made out of and how can we make good use out of minerals that are found inside asteroids. Is this a good idea to bring some of those asteroids back to the Earth and use them for useful purposes on the Earth? So go and plan a visit at the UCLA Meteorite Gallery with your parents, with your classmates. It's a very nice visit. I heard that on Sundays, they actually give tours and you can talk to the scientists and make arrangements before that. And let's see where we are moving next here. The next slide. Aha, okay, the next slide shows what one of those people who live in Russia saw 7 years ago as he was driving or she was driving to work that morning. They have a camera in their car, and as they were driving to work, they saw this big second sun in the sky for just a few seconds. It was an asteroid that entered our planet the morning of that day, which tells us those objects are real. Those objects are a real concern because that asteroid injured over 1,000 people that day in Russia. So we need to do something about these objects. Here's another one that was also caught on camera. And can you guess where is this object going to hit on the ground? Very, very difficult to guess because we are looking into the sky. But let's follow this object as it enters through the atmosphere. Do you know what force breaks this object into smaller and smaller pieces? It's the force of friction with the molecules of the atmosphere. And so the object is coming down and down and down, and it is headed into the city of New York, and it actually collided and hit this car and caused damage to this car. Let's see if we can see the next picture. Yeah. So here's the car and the meteorite that made it down to the ground. And I think that the car and the meteorite were sold to a local museum in New York. The next time I'm going to go to New York, I'm going to see if I can go see this car and the meteorite. So now we are aware that those objects can cause damage on the ground. So what can we do about this? What can we do about those objects, about those natural space objects that we can do to protect our community? The very first thing that we want to do is we want to discover those objects before they find us. We want to find them before they find us. How do we do that? Very simply, we are going to take pictures of the night sky during a clear night, and we are going to try to find objects that are moving relative to the galaxies and nebulas and stars that don't move very quickly or almost at all. You can see here, we see an object moving across the sky, and that's how we find asteroids, by taking a few shots of the night sky, looking for objects that are moving about, or just objects that appear that did not exist there yesterday. Here is an example, another example of a person, an astronomer, that did stargazing, that looked at the host nebula, in Orion, and at the upper corner of his picture, we see an asteroid sneaking about, showing how those asteroids are discovered. So now let's do a little bit of an exercise. I'll give you a few seconds to dim the lights in your rooms completely, to make it really, really dark. Only look at the computer screen, because I'm going to ask you to find an asteroid on your own. Are you ready? I think so. So let's move to the next slide here. And this is a picture of the night sky before the asteroid was discovered. So look carefully at this picture. In the next image, you will try to find a new object that did not exist in this frame. I'm going to go to the next frame now, and it's just about to appear on the screen. Okay. Can you see a new object that appeared on the screen that did not exist before? Let me go back one time. I'm going back to the previous one. This is the night sky before the asteroid was discovered. And now I'm going to go forward. As you can see, it's quite difficult to identify the new object. There are many new little changes on the screen here, but I'm going to help you out by pointing out the new object that just got added. In the next frame, you should see which object it is. So that arrow shows that this little dot of light appeared in the sky and did not exist before. So now that we found a new asteroid, we have to track it down. We need to make sure, where is this asteroid moving to? Where is it going? So we are going to track it down, and after a day or two, it is found in a new location in the sky, and after a few days, it's going to be found in yet another new location in the sky. So now we have a few dots to connect, and we can create the trajectory of this asteroid as it moves in the sky. And we know where it is today. The question that we are asking ourselves is, where is this asteroid going? We have experts at Aerospace and elsewhere that are calculating, where is this asteroid moving to? We would like to calculate whether in the future this asteroid might come to collide with our planet Earth and potentially cause damage. We would like to protect ourselves from that. How do we do that? We would like to launch a heavy satellite to collide with the asteroid and push it off the Earth. You can see here the satellite moving and pushing the asteroid off the Earth. And that's how to deflect it away from the Earth and save our community. Okay, so the blue lines represent missiles that are being shot out to intercept asteroids, marked by the red line coming from the sky. If we could not deflect those asteroids when they are far out in space, we have to try to break them down soon before they enter into the atmosphere. Or maybe some of you would like to become rocket scientists and missile scientists that will build those missiles that would deflect those asteroids and break them down before they cause damage on the ground. And the next slide should be in the summary. So in conclusion, my message to you is that we have to be prepared. We talked about junk that is made by men and junk that is made by nature, space junk, and both of these can cause damage. And we would like to find good ideas how to clean space from both man-made and nature-made junk. And for that, I will give you a mission, and your mission is do well in school. if you will do well in school today, you can be a scientist, aerospace engineer, musician, journalist, photograph, and just be very successful. So your mission today is do well in school. With that, I'd like to thank you for listening to me.
Thank you, Nahum, and thank you, everyone, for joining us. We are at the hour now, so I want to take a minute to say a huge thank you for taking time for being with us today for our first seminar. Remember that this session is being recorded, and you will be able to find it on AU's seminar webpage or the Aerospace Corporation's YouTube channel in the future. We want to continue to bring these seminars, so if you do have any ideas, parents, feel free to send that into seminar@aero.org. Next week, we will have another seminar on rockets with John Binkley, and we hope to see you there soon. I want to thank everyone in the chat who is helping field some questions. I know we weren't able to get all of them in our session today, so I want to thank you for that. And if you do have any additional questions, feel free to send them to seminar@aero.org as well. Aerospace employees, you are welcome to enter this time as continued learning credit, as external learning in the TLC. I will post the link to instructions in the chat. And thank you again. We hope to see you soon.